able to work with you because you haven't gone down there and...
No, that's not the issue in this conversation, although, you know, you keep trying to make...
All right, are there any such statements?
What do you mean such statements? Do you mean statements about free speech?
Look, read what it says.
What it says is...
Any statements or opinions of experts obtained by defendants. Any statements...
Or opinions by anybody, any person,
regarding any or the... Do you have any?
Yes, and I'm telling you, and I'll say it again, that when you phrase it this way, you are asking for anything that...
answer my question.
Free speech, because free...
Answer my question. Do you have any such... You don't know. Okay, let's move on.
Do you want to narrow this request? If you don't, just say no, we can go on. If you do, we can talk about how you would narrow it to get something reasonable out of it. If you don't, if you want to just leave it the way it is, then the judge can decide based on this.
Do you have any such...
If you don't want to just say, it would be much easier if you just said no.
Well, I know. You and you're much easier. Like adding UACC, Columbia, or Cablevision, or Westchester. You think I'll ever fall for that again? I'm asking you, do you have any such statements?
You know what you're asking me, and I...
Well, what's the answer then?
I don't know. I haven't asked. I haven't taken this request because we have not... I don't think it's a proper request. So I don't think... I can't respond to your question. And what difference does it make whether I have any or not? We're trying to find out what the request is going to be, not whether I have any or not. If I have some, okay. Whatever the request is, if this is the request I respond to, find out if I have any against this. If the judge says, no, you don't have to answer on that one, then what you have to do is some variant of this, whatever he decides.
Oh, come on, let's move on. I don't have time for this. We're up to 16.
Yeah, good, 16. Okay, 16.
Do you have any investigators? Have you done an investigation?
Of what? I mean, this is... Of what?
Oh, here we are again. You know, you have a great problem with comprehension. Let's go on to 17.
You don't... 18. Not 17. She says, copies of any statement.
You can't even answer a simple question. Are there any investigations going on? So let's go on.
They could be investigating something in, they could be investigating somebody stealing service.
Mm-hmm. Oh, sure. That's what this is about. Sure. Okay. It's okay. It's hopeless. Never mind. Go on to 18, please.
Do you want to limit 17 to talk about anything, you know, to limit it in any way?
I think we all know what the investigation...
We all know this, but unless you put it in writing, then...
You're wrong. Okay. We're up to 18. Copies of the franchises.
I take it.
Can you understand that?
From your comments, you don't want to change 17.
You can take what you want, but I haven't said. So stop trying to manipulate. Up to 18 copies of the franchises. Do you know what franchises are? I want them all produced for 20 towns.
I have no objection to 18.
Okay. All documents which refer to up to 19 or relate to or reflect the marketing of defendant services as aided by public access. Do you market?
I have no objection to 19.
Okay. 20.
Commission response. 20. I don't think you can ask me this, or I won't answer this one, but I would...
Oh, yes, I have a right to know that. And just the way I have a right to know witnesses.
You think it's...
You're going to have to answer it eventually.
I don't think you may get an answer later. I don't think you get an answer now.
I don't think so. Okay, that's the end. Now, what are you going to do about these interrogatories you haven't answered?
No. We just had a conference. We tried to resolve some things. I don't think we resolved much. Now it's my burden. I think I said to the judge I would do this. I would write a letter. Things we didn't resolve, then I write a letter to the judge. I have to write a two-page letter is improper or otherwise overbroad.
I'm talking about interrogatories. What are you going to do about that?
I think that was it, folks. Judge Fox, you heard Judge Fox say that all discovery and interrogatories had to be in by April 5th. That's tomorrow. So if we don't get them in, they're waived. So the next thing to do is to I think I'll send new interrogatories, and I think I'll send new discovery for documents by tomorrow the 5th. And I'll also write to Judge Fox and complain to him about Wiles being as unresponsive as possible. Did you ever hear anything like that? Okay. That happened on a Monday, April the 1st, April Fool's Day, 1996, from 3:07 p.m. to 3:50 p.m. The last part of it was cut off. The last part went very fast because somebody came in to see him. Thank heaven. Now then, folks, I think that we're on program 2666, public access programs, Chat with Glendora, which started in 1973. So it'd be 23 years ago. And I think we're all done listening to that screwball lawyer, Ben Wiles. And we'll fill in the rest of the week what happened with the TCI law-breaking, lying, and cover-up. But first, we've got to have some jokes. And do you know what the judge said to the dentist? Do you swear to pull the tooth, the whole tooth, and nothing but the tooth? And the man walking down the street, passing a men's store, he saw a suit in the window, and he went in and he says, "May I try on that navy blue suit in the window?" And the store owner says, "No, you'll have to use the dressing room." And Pete says, "You see that man over there?" And Charlie says, "Yeah." Pete says, "I owe more to that man than anybody else in my life." Charlie says, "Yeah, who is he?" And Pete says, "My landlord." Now, this is Easter morning. Actually, it's the day after Easter. And it's 2:27 a.m. And we have been doing TCI all day Easter, except for going to church. They ruined Christmas. I told you they ruined Valentine's Day, and they ruined St. Patrick's Day, and they ruined Lent with their law-breaking and their arrogance and their ignorance. And I guess I told you they would ruin Easter. Well, they certainly did. Now, where do we pick up? First of all, I think it's these logs that weren't done. These copies go to Brad Sachs. These logs weren't done for 2 weeks because there was so much work to do on TCI we didn't get to the logs. Okay, I found them. These logs have to be reduced. I have to be reduced too, and these logs have to be cut. And then that's
master made, and then 25 copies made and sent to the lawbreakers, Malone, Magnus, TCI, etc. This is where we left off. We got way behind, and this is the log for the week of March the 18th, and here are the stats. 603, $6.08, 11 and 3 quarters hours, a total of 428 hours, a total of $744.11, and $120,500 in lawyer's fees. March the 18th was the day that TCI,
I don't know if you heard those figures or not, that's the day that TCI violated the discovery and wouldn't show me the insurance agreement and wouldn't show me the public file. They're really crooked people. Its total is 482 hours, $744, and $120,500 in lawyer's fees, legal work. TCI takes television into yesterday. TCI takes television into yesterday. Okay, now we have the log of the week of March the 25th. The logs got coupled. Like Franklin and I have been coupled for 41 years. What I read to you were the statistics for the week of March the 25th, and previous to that is the statistics for the week of March the 18th. And on March the 18th, we were into the 15th week of this lawbreaking by Malone, Magnus, and TCI. 12 volumes of bad record and 2,100 pages. Those are the statistics. Okay, here are the statistics for the week of April the 1st, April Fool's Week. 528 and 3 quarters hours, $797.77, and it's $250 for legal work, and so you multiply that by the 528 and 3 quarters hours, and you get $132,187.50 in legal work. This is the 18th week of their law breaking. It's the 40th mailing and 2,200 pages of bad record and 7 volumes. Something very mysterious has happened to the business certificate of TCI, United UACC Columbia Cablevision, Westchester. But in looking through the county clerk's office, we found this. You see that signature there? Robert F. Nafee. He's one of our defendants. And if you go on farther, you see it again. This has to do with a merger of a whole bunch of theaters, movie theaters. And it turns out that the undersigned, Robert A. Nafee, is president of United Artists Communications Incorporated. And he was a director, and he was sued as being responsible in his part for this decision to violate our freedom of speech and 531E. And New York State 829.3, no cable operator shall exercise editorial control over public use of channel. So he was a defendant and he was sued. I found out that a present director, Jerome Kern, has an office in Manhattan. So we will be researching that this week. So anyway, this is about NAFI, and I found this in the county clerk's office, although we can't find their business certificate. We have one copy of the business certificate, and I think I showed it to you at this time, and I think I have another one signed by Earl Quam. So we have to see what these people are up to and if they're registered in Westchester County to do business. These are the papers that went out from February the 20th up to April the 7th, Friday. Legal papers, motions, and so I think it would be a good idea to have these all bound, don't you? And all of these papers have been read to you. You know the contents of them all. This is the second set of legal papers, like the first, to be bound, but you have to keep one copy unbound, because if you bind them, they can't print them because of the holes punched in the paper. They clog up the copying machine. So you have to have another set unbound because you will need that set for the appellant's brief and appellant's exhibits. When the appellant's brief is written for that terrible decision by Judge Connor to rob Glendora of her defendants, an outrageous decision, an outrageous miscarriage of justice. And this set of papers, it's the same group, have to be, it's the papers that went out in March. And it has to be March the 19th, it was five papers. And then the four papers that went out on April the 5th, Friday. No, those don't have to be reduced because those were sent to all defendants. These will have to be reduced, and then they will have to be cut, and then a master will have to be made, and then they will have to be printed 25 copies and sent to all of these lawbreakers. For that you and I read together, legal paper was the notice of appeal of that same decision that we just spoke of. Here is the second round of document, no, interrogatories to these defendants. Juan Glendora specifies that you yourselves must answer, not your lawyer, and that you must sign the answers, not your lawyer, and that you must declare under penalty of perjury that you have told the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. Two, you have 30 days to answer, not including the day of service, which is April 5th, 1996, Friday. Three, Local Rule 46A states, and then at the commencement of discovery, interrogatories will be restricted to those seeking names of witnesses with knowledge of information relevant to the subject matter of the action, the computation of such category of damages alleged, and the existence, custodian, location, and general description of relevant documents. And then Federal Rules of Civil Procedure, Rule 33 states, each interrogatory shall be answered separately and fully in writing under oath unless it is objected to, in which event the objecting party state the reasons for objection and shall answer to the extent the interrogatory is not objectionable. See, this is discovery, and that's a legal term for lie. Cover up. Five, you must follow these rules precisely. If you do not, Glendora will move the court to compel you to follow these rules and Glendora's instructions. And if you fail to tell the truth, Glendora will move for money sanctions and contempt pursuant to Federal Rules of Civil Procedure, Rule 37. Discovery, interrogatories, documents, depositions, admissions, and inspection of your premises is your chance to show you are innocent, that you did nothing wrong, and that the jury should find you not guilty. Lying and being evasive will show the court and the jury just the opposite. You have an obligation to be as responsive as possible and give complete answers. Remember, you have to answer, not your lawyer. Not your lawyer. You are the one responsible for what you did, right or wrong. Take notice, not one individual listed in the caption above responded to Glendora's interrogatories issued to you February 3rd, 1996. You have 10 days from today, April the 5th, 1996, to answer Glendora's first demand for a verified answer to interrogatories pursuant to Local Rule 46, page 24. Take notice, Mr. Wicker and Mr. Wiles have not answered Glendora's objections issued March the 11th, 1996, Monday. You have 10 days from today, April 5th, 1996, to answer the same. Each person listed in the caption supra was sent March the 11th, 1996, Glendora's objections mentioned in the last paragraph. Each of you must pay attention to these objections and not commit the same fraud Messrs. Wicker and Wiles did. End of instructions. Interrogatories. What is the name of the cable TV system you work for? Does this cable TV system have a channel 8? How long have you worked for this cable TV system? What is your job and what does it consist of? Is channel 8 countywide? Is channel 8 system-wide? What type of programming was cable cast over channel 8 in the first quarter of 1996, in 1995, 1994, 3, 2, 1, 90, 1989, 1988, 1987, 1986, 1985, 1984, 1983, and 1982. If you do not know, please ask somebody who does, i.e. Ira Birnbaum. What year did public access begin on Channel 8? If you do not know, please ask somebody who does. Did TCI of Westchester announce it would take public access program off Channel 8? When? Who made this decision? Who originated this idea? When? Was it more than one person? Who? When did you first hear of this decision? Henceforth, decision will mean the decision to take public access programs off Channel 8. Were there meetings to discuss this decision? When was it announced to the company insiders? By whom? Where? Did you attend any meetings that discussed this decision? Did you comment on the matter? If so, what did you say? By what authority did the company, TCI, say it could take the public access programs off Channel 8? How long does the company claim they have had this authority? Why did the company TCI of Westchester never decide before to take the public access programs off of Channel 8? What makes them think they can do it now? On what channel will the public access programs be cablecast if they are not cablecast on Channel 8? Are there conclusive and unassailable arrangements made to have the public access programs cablecast on another channel? Do you have anything in writing or any contracts assuring the public access programs will be cablecast? Did TCI of Westchester announce that the public access programs would be cablecast on channels 14, 15, 16 of the municipalities? Did the municipalities agree to cablecast the Channel 8 public access programs on their public access channels? Did TCI of Westchester, the company, announce that starting February 1st, 1996, no more public access programs would be cablecast over Channel 8? Did that happen? Why not? Is a chat with Glendora a public access program? If a chat with Glendora is not cablecast on Channel 8, on what channel of TCI Westchester will it be cablecast on? What firm arrangements have been made for this? Is Channel 7 a highly viewed channel? Is Channel 9? Is Channel 8 then between two highly viewed channels? Is Channel 13 as highly viewed as Channel 7 and Channel 8? Is Channel 14? Is Channel 15? Is Channel 16? Is Channel 17? If Glendora's program is taken off Channel 8 system-wide and on Channel 14, 15, 16 system-wide, will as many people be apt to see it? Have you seen a chat with Glendora? If yes, how many times have you? What are your thoughts about it? Does public access cost the company money? If so, how much money does public access cost the company per year? If you do not know it, would you please find out? If public access programming were to be taken off Channel 8, what programming would replace it? Does this programming increase revenue to TCI? Does TCI of Westchester have a responsibility to cablecast public access programming? If so, would you please list to whom and in compliance with what laws? Do municipalities have a responsibility to cablecast public access programming that was on Channel 8 if such programming is taken off Channel 8? What is WRNN? What is Must Carry? Does WRNN qualify for Must Carry? What is Gannett Newspapers? Does Gannett Newspapers in Westchester have a program on WRNN? When is the program on WRNN, time and day? What is the program about? Who is on the program? Has Gannett had stories in the newspaper about TCI taking public access off Channel 8? If yes, how many stories has Gannett had? What did each story say? Has Gannett urged TCI in any way to carry WRNN? Does the WRNN signal have to be boosted to get to TCI of Westchester? If yes, how many times does it have to be boosted? Have you urged in any way? Have you been urged in any way by Gannett to carry WRNN on TCI of Westchester? Did anybody at TCI tell the franchise authorities before the franchises were renewed that TCI planned to take public access off of Channel 8? If yes, specify all persons, TCI, and franchise persons by name, address, and telephone number. Who is the lawyer for John Malone? Bob Magnus, Telecommunications Incorporated, Brendan Clouston, Robert Thompson, Barry Marshall, Donnie A. Fisher, John W. Gallivan, Kim Magnus, Robert F. Nafee, Paul J. O'Brien, Mary Magarelli, John Wicker, Nona Carey Dunn, Miles Rich, UACC Columbia Cablevision of Westchester, doing business as TCI Cable of Westchester. List the dates each was represented in court, by whom and for what purposes. These interrogatories will be ongoing until the truth is told, the whole truth and nothing but the truth, or until the threat of robbing Glendora and others of their Channel 8 public access channel is gone forever. Reminder, you must answer the first set of interrogatories as stated in paragraphs 9, 10, and 11 of pages 4 and 5 in this paper. Dated White Plains, New York, April 5th, 1996, yours in truth, Glendora, chat with Glendora. Under penalty of perjury, Glendora swears she served a copy of the Within upon Ben Wiles by United States Mail First Class. It goes to each individual listed in the caption and to Judges Fox, Connor, Laval, Cabranes, and Sand. This is the second paper that went out April the 5th, and this is the second round for documents. And this is defendants John C. Malone, Bob Magnus, Telecommunications Incorporated, Brendan Clouston, Robert Thompson, Barry Marshall, Donnie A. Fisher, John W. Gallivan, Kim Magnus, Robert F. Nafee, Paul J. O'Brien, Brian Sullivan, Scott Brown, Mary Magarelli, John Wicker, Nona Carey Dunn, Miles Rich, and any other John or Jane Doe defendants may claim as a necessary party in UACC Columbia Cablevision Incorporated of Westchester Incorporated, DBA, TCI of Westchester. Plaintiff Appellant Glendora hereby requests pursuant to Federal Rules of Civil Procedure Rule 34 that defendants produce the documents and things herein after. Procedure Rule 34, that defendants produce the documents and things hereinafter described for inspection and copying by forwarding true copies of each document and thing covered by this request to Glendora, Box 416, White Plains, New York, 1062, within 30 days after service of this request. And here are all the instructions which were read to you. And here's a copy of Rule 34. Documents requested, all insurance policies, relevant or not, Glendora will examine them and determine if they are relevant. Copy of business certificate, Westchester County, all business certificates since the company began in Westchester, and for all the various names this company has been in business under. Proof of appearances before the courts, both U.S. District Court and U.S. Court of Appeals since Glendora versus Malone Magnus TCI began. Proof of what lawyer or lawyers represented which defendant or defendants, all 17 defendants, what dates, and for what purposes? In writing what Joshua N. Kearney said before Judge Connor, beginning to end, January 23rd, 1996, Tuesday, 9 a.m. to 10:40 a.m., and written by Kearney. Inspection of all public access files at 609 Center Street, Mamaroneck, or at any other location for TCI Cable of Westchester. Copy of the technical audit report and all papers relevant to such audit done by the New York Public Service Commission, the first quarter of 1996. All documents having to do with WRNN and TCI. All documents having to do with Gannett and TCI. The entire file having to do with taking Channel 8 away from the public access producers. All files having to do with the cost of public access to TCI of Westchester for the entire year of 1995 and for this year of 1996 to date. All newspaper articles having to do with TCI of Westchester taking Channel 8 away from public access producers. Copies of all payments to franchise municipalities, all 20 of them from TCI of Westchester. Proof of Mr. O'Brien's death. The current address of Robert F. Nafee. The names, addresses, and telephone numbers of all experts defendants intend to present, either orally or by papers. The names of all witnesses defendants intend to produce. All discovery demands on defendants by plaintiff listed in Glendora, plaintiff appellant's first request to defendants for production of documents and things. Served on you, March the 13th, 1996. Please take note, Glendora is armed and dangerous, meaning with books by the Federal Judicial Center. That paper was served and submitted on April the 5th, 1996, Friday. This is the third paper that was submitted April 5th, 1996, Friday. And this is for all defendants, and it is an objection to Judge Fox. This is a two-page letter brief to Judge Fox. You ordered Ben Wiles and Glendora to discuss discovery demands in your courtroom following our conference with you, 1:15 p.m. to 2:30 p.m. It was a good conference, a good case management schedule, and good moving along. Mr. Wiles defied your order and said he would postpone the document discussion until Monday at 3 p.m. and do it by phone. Then Mr. Wiles launched successive attempts to manipulate Glendora out of depositions, presenting costs for minutes, telling her what to do in the United States Court of Appeals Second Circuit, and telling her how to write interrogatories. At 3.07 p.m., Mr. Wiles called Glendora. We discussed document requests until 3.50 p.m. He quibbled about every word. He would not commit to the name, address, telephone number, and name of account executive of the defendant's insurance company. He obstructed the progress with asking the same questions over and over and quibbling over every word. Glendora presents his audio tape of how it went, April the 1st, 1996, Monday, 3.07 p.m. to 3.40 p.m. The last part went fast because Mr. Wiles had a caller in his office and wanted to tend the same. That was a blessing, so he quickly went over numbers 9, 17, 18, 19, and 20. So there are disputes as to number 1, number 4, number 5, voicemail, all audio tapes and audio videotapes, public statements, third parties, investigators. Glendora questions that defendants, all 17 of them, were properly represented in court on January 23, 1996, Tuesday at 9 a.m. to 10:40 a.m., and if legitimate appearances were made, Mr. Wiles showed up representing somebody who was not a party to the action, and his representation of the parties is nebulous. She has to investigate this further. These 17 defendants may all be in default, and the lawsuit may all be over. A lawyer in Denver told Glendora that Malone, Magnus, and several others did not appear. No appearance, she said. Glendora can find no appearance sheets in this file. As of today, Mr. Wiles has not produced the home addresses ordered by Judge Connor and then by you, pursuant to Local Rule 2, and your statement, Judge Connor's honors order, speaks for itself. There is a dispute about the interrogatories. The answers are not proper. They didn't tell me anything. Glendora, found your hearing and ruling on the new care subpoena very interesting. Please refer to this case as Glendora versus Malone, not Glendora versus Marshall. Glendora appealed Judge Kahn as robbing her of her defendants. He did it on an assumption and before discovering from Glendora's audio tape proof that contradicts his statement. There is in truth Glendora, chat with Glendora. And here is the fourth paper that went out to the United States Court of Appeals, Second Circuit. And this is an motion for an emergency stay. There was a motion for an emergency stay on January 23rd, but after the motion for emergency stay was submitted, TCI capitulated. They postponed. They're robbing us of Channel 8, public access channel. They postponed it 30 to 60 days. May 1st will be 90 days. This is April the 8th. Actually, it's April 7th, Easter morning at 3:20 a.m. So you remember that, and I want an emergency stay naturally for the same reasons as before, based upon this article that was in Gannett. And they're going to eliminate the public access channel, this article says, May 1st. Well, we haven't been notified. We haven't heard a thing from TCI. So this is the same argument why we should have an emergency stay, that they should not be allowed to do that. And because I have an appeal, a pending there, at the United States Court of Appeals. An injunction to get for them to rule an injunction, preliminary injunction, if they never be allowed to do this during the pendency of this lawsuit. Joseph says, you remind me of Dan Smith. And Arthur says, I'm not a thing like Dan Smith. Joseph says, yes, you are. You both owe me $10. And Fred said that he's taken up painting professionally, and Donald said, well, have you sold anything? And Fred says, yes, my car, my television set, and my watch. And John was asked, why are you so well behaved? And John says, it's my father. Whenever I was well behaved, he gave me a penny, he pat me on the head. So by the time I was 15 years old, I had $17 and a flat head. Now, papers that were written yesterday on Easter and are going out April 8th, Monday. Ben Wiles wrote a letter saying all kinds of nonsense about the first round of interrogatories. This is Glendora's answer to that nonsense. To Ben Wiles, who can never tell the plaintiff, call the plaintiff by name in the caption. This is plain stupid. And it's regarding Glendora versus Malone. In answer to your April Fool's Day letter, the reason the interrogatories were not discussed is that you had a caller and cut the conversation off. As the second interrogatory is issued, April the 5th, 1990, Friday, stated not one defendant has answered the interrogatories issued on February the 3rd, 1996. All are in default. There is no defendant, UA Columbia Cable Vision of Westchester Incorporated, doing business as TCI Cable of Westchester. There is no case, Glendora versus Marshall. There is no party to the action, Glendora Buell. There is no record, nor proof, nor appearance sheet that any of the defendants Glendora sued ever appeared. They are all in default and owe Glendora $350 million. There is a dispute concerning the first interrogatories. The Honorable Mark D. Fox has it in his file. It is on the record. The dispute has arisen. Glendora wrote you the objectives to the first round The objections to the first round answers, March 11, 1996, and to the court. Let me say it again. You have 3 business days to resolve the dispute. This letter to you is being mailed April the 8th, 1996, Monday. You will receive it Tuesday. Your answer goes out Friday. I have 5 business days to bring it up to Judge Fox. That will be Monday the 15th. I just need one day. And here are the rules. Judge Fox's rules and the local rule 3F. And here's this screwy letter by Ben Wiles. These are the rules, Judge Fox's rules and rule 3F. And here's the screwy letter by Ben Wiles. Now there's another paper to go out Monday, March the 8th. And that's in response to Ben Wiles' second letter to Glendora. And here, I'll show you his letter. This is my answer. Glendora versus Malone Magnus TCI et al. A dispute arose on April 1st, 1996, Monday. Wiles says, however, in our discussion concerning request 8, I ask if you wish to make the request broader to encompass meetings which might have discussed the use of Channel 8 for public access programming generally. You indicated that you did not wish to alter the request, therefore the response will be to the request as written. Glendora, you respond truthfully to the document demand, and they both will be answered. There is no reason defendants cannot produce Glendora's document request number 13. If they do not, we have a dispute. Glendora's document demand number 20 must be met. We have a dispute if it is not. Defendants have failed to deal with Glendora's document requests 1, 2, 3, 7, 9, 14, 15, 16, and 17. Glendora is sending you her opposition herein on April 8, 1996, Monday. You have 5 days to address Judge Fox with the dispute. Yours in truth, Glendora. The process here is that it has to first of all be served upon Ben Wiles, and then it has to be taken to the federal courthouse, and a copy goes to Judge Connor, a copy goes to Judge Fox. A copy, the main copy, the original, goes to the clerk, and then Glendora's copy has to be stamped, received. And Chris, a clerk at the United States District Court, Friday, I had made a little box, and I said this space is reserved for the clerk, so the clerk's going to never find a place to stamp it. So she says, hey, that's cool. And here is the starting of the 8th file, and this would be for April. And that was started yesterday. Too bad these people have to break the law. It's too bad they have to rob the intent of Congress and the New York State Legislature in their greedy, greedy, arrogant, and ignorant way. We received from the United States Court of Appeals. This is the acknowledgement letter. These people do such a good job. They have a little problem with the zip code for 4 years. Oh, I guess it's really 3 years. The acknowledgement letter that you receive it, that the names are correct. Everything's okay except the zip code. So that good way that they do, they send out this acknowledgement letter and then they send you instructions, And this is the Second Circuit, and then they send you a docket. That's nice because the United States District Court in White Plains charges you 50 cents a page. I think that's against the New York State Freedom of Information Law. The most you can charge is 25 cents a page, and that's outrageous. It shouldn't be more than 3 cents a page. Anyhow, they do a good job at the United States Court of Appeals on the Second Circuit. Now, the next thing that will be along, they have ordered the United States District Court to submit the record on appeal. That means the file. And I believe the file for this case is already down in the United States Court of Appeals. But they'll have to send the file from... What would that be? January. February. Half of February. And now they'll have to send the rest of it down while the battle rages in the Judge Connor Court. I don't understand that. And I think there's something very strange about it. And so the United States Court of Appeals ordered the United States District Court to ship them the record on appeal. This is so much better than the appellate division. You have to ship the record on appeal. The United States Court of Appeals receives the record on appeal, and then they get out a scheduling order, and they say, you, Glendora, appellant, you have your brief in 30 days, and they give you the date. And you, appellees, lawbreakers, TCI, you have your brief in 30 days later. And you, Glendora, if you want to make a reply brief, you have that in 10 days. And expect an oral argument in a week. So they do a whole lot better than the state courts. State courts are hopelessly lost. Well, about this appeal is about Judge Connor robbing Glendora of her defendants. Outrageous miscarriage of justice. Now there's two appeals down there on Judge Connor. The first one was on his denying temporary restraining order. Oh, big business. Anti-freedom of speech. And then the second appeal is about Judge Connor robbing us of our defendants. Another pro big business decision. The cases at Miami-Dade Curiae have had a New York Citizens Committee on Cable TV versus Manhattan Cable TV, Missouri Knights of the versus Kansas City, Alliance for Community Media versus the FCC, and the First Amendment and the Media, Current Issues in Telecommunications Law and Cable Television. So they know a lot about public access. That's Brian D. Grafman and Robert T. Perry. The issues involved in this lawsuit involving rights of access to and censorship of cable television public access channels transcend the instant dispute and are of immense public importance. Here the plaintiff appellant is appearing pro se. In this unusual situation, an amicus curiae brief written by counsel experienced in this field should greatly assist the court and ensure a complete and plenary presentation of the difficult issues therein so that the court may reach a proper decision. In such circumstances, participation by amicus curiae is appropriate. Pro se applicant Glendora has consented to the relief sought by this application. So that was their application. That was granted by Judge Bryant. It took all of Easter Day, Sunday, other than going to church, and to worship our great and wonderful God. It took all day to do the TCI file. The TCI file is one whole file drawer. It's over 2,100 pages. It all had to be reviewed. It all had to be paginated, and it had to be put into volumes month by month, or however they come out. And there are 8 volumes, as you know. So that's a tremendous outlay of time and life. Now this is the annual report. And their greed in here is rampant. And thank heavens that we have a Securities Exchange Commission that makes them disclose it. crooked and greedy CEOs. I have an employment contract and termination of employment and change of control arrangements. Effective November 1st, 1992, the employment agreements between TCI and Mr. Magnus and Dr. Malone were further amended and restated. So you see, they keep protecting themselves with the greed. And even after they have, if it is taken over by somebody, the way Tisch took over CBS, for instance, even if that happens, Malone and Magnus and Vieira and Clouston and Sparkman, they all have themselves protected so that they get paid for 2 years, whether they're working for the company or not, whether it's been taken over by somebody else or not. That's how crooked and greedy and shamelessly so these people are. We have the report of the Compensation Committee, the committee that decides on the compensation of Malone, Magnus, Clouston, Vieira, and Sparkman. The company will pay Mr. Sparkman's 240 consecutive monthly payments of $6,250, increased at the rate of 12% per annum. That's Katie with the plastic bag. The Compensation Committee, they don't tell you who's on it, but it's probably Malone and Magnus who are deciding the salaries of Malone and Magnus. Now they get a basic salary, folks, and then they get equity-based incentives. You know, they do a good job, they're going to get more money. And then they have a deductibility of executive compensation. Their stock options. Folks, there were six board meetings. Mr. Bob Magnus and Dr. Malone, each of whom is a director and executive officer of the company. You know, I thought Cablevision was bad with all of its names of companies and this and that, mixing this and that, and partnerships and this, but TCI is worse. So it must be typical of all cable operators. The same typical thing that we've said before, greed. Mr. Jerome H. Kern, a director of the company, is a partner with the law firm of Baker and Botts, the principal outside counsel for the company. Fees paid to Baker and Botts by the company and TCI were $10,069,871. So it's big business, isn't it, dear? On February 3rd, 1994, Dr. Malone, then an executive officer and director of TCI, borrowed $310,000 from TCI. Such indebtedness bore interest at the Bank of New York prime rate. Dr. Malone repaid such indebtedness, including accrued interest, amounting to $1,700. On October 24, 1991, Dr. Malone exercised certain options granted to him by LMC through the delivery of $100,000 in cash and a promissory note in the amount of $25.5 million. The promissory note Dr. Malone delivered to LMC bore interest at the rate of 7.54% per annum and was secured by 16 million shares of LMC Class B common stock. Why does he keep borrowing all this money, Dr. Malone? And then there's three or four paragraphs more about that. Takeover considerations, how they're going to keep somebody else from taking over the company. I don't see why they should care. They get paid just as much whether they're working there or not working there. Legal matters. And this is what Mr. Kern got paid so much for. The firm B&B that I told you about a moment ago. Mr. Kern holds options to purchase 2 million shares of Class A common stock. I don't know if that's right. The lawyer owns shares in the company Baker and Botts. Their independent auditors, and of course you can't trust them either, are Pete Marwick. Proposal by stockholders for which consideration is desired at the 1996 annual meeting of stockholders must be received by the company by March 1st, 1996. So we missed that. This is April the 8th. When I asked for an annual report, instead of giving me the glossy color copy, this is what they sent me. A printing machine copy. So this is a picture of the lawbreakers. Bob, this is John Malone and Bob Magnus. Bob Magnus is the one toward you. Malone is the one in the background. These are the people making $5 or $6 million a year and out breaking the law and out robbing us of public access. So that's all of the reports this week, the week of April the 4th. No, this is really the week of April the 4th. This will be from April the March the 28th to April the 4th. And from April the 4th to April the 8th on the law breaking of PCI, Malone, Magnus, Clouston, all of those people whose names I hope are on the screen. Paper for sale. Large crystal vase by lady, slightly cracked. Calf on a hypochondriac's tombstone. See, I told you I was sick. To a store and said he wanted to buy a mattress, and the clerk said a spring mattress, and the bachelor said, no, I want one I can sleep on all year round. The annual meeting of Gannett. Here's their annual report and their proxy statement. Remember all those outrageous salaries and the greed of John Curley? People that I sued, that's a proxy statement, tell you about that. And here's the Gannett annual report. And it's Gannett, oh, those are great pictures, aren't they? Look like a three-year-old. McCorkendale and all the other ones I see that I sued. And these are all the, this is the same propaganda. Mr. Lewis, would think that Curly makes about $8 million a year. These are the reports that they have to reveal. You know, they used to do this surreptitiously, but the Securities Exchange Commission makes them review these things. And the Texaco annual meeting will be in Houston this year. This will be the last year that Alfred Dufresne is the CEO. Then we have greedy GEICO, like all insurance companies, and the lobby of the insurance industry on the legislators in Albany making the insurance go up. Mine goes up now $30. And I don't even want the insurance. I don't need the insurance. Look at my record. And they compel you to have insurance. And we're manipulated by the insurance industry and the legislators in Albany who don't look out for us. Here's a letter from Thomas Galata saying that he got my letter, that the Jeff Bunshaft and Owen Walsh, county attorneys in Nassau, that they received the letter to Philip Sweet. They opened it, they put the letter back in the envelope, they sealed it, and they sent it back on my postage that I had bought. And they cheated the post office out of the postage that they should have paid. The Classical High School class of 1946 reunion. I don't think I'll have time to go to that, and that's terrible. It's the 50th high school reunion, and I was president of that high school class in 1946. His family circle is consistently good and consistently funny, and Franklin is a big fan of it. Do vegetarians eat animal crackers? And here's the Katie Cat. Hi, Katie Cat. What time is it? It's 4:12 a.m. The Easter was yesterday. Americans for Legal Reform, protecting us against the greed of lawyers. Their telephone number in Long Island is 516-421-6390. And now we're up to the Appellate Division, Second Department, Supreme Court of the State of New York. And I read you a little bit from that book every day. Although the Appellate Division is primarily a tribunal to decide causes, which of course they do very badly, it also functions in ancillary capacities. The court is invested with authority over attorney discipline. Well, you can see how good a job they're doing there, and decides matters involving serious misconduct that have been referred to it by one of three grievance committees that operate in the Second Department. In 1994, the court disbarred 54 law attorneys, suspended 24 more, and censured 9. Hooray! The court administers the admission of attorneys to the bar. They certainly do a bad job of that, overseeing the process through the operation of its two committees on character and fitness of lawyers. Swearing-in ceremonies for new attorneys are regularly conducted in the courtroom. In 1994, a total of 2,394 individuals were admitted to the practice of law in the Second Department. That's a curse on society. The Appellate Division also administers a law guardian program under which attorneys are appointed to act on behalf of children in various legal contexts. The law guardian program provides substantial support services for little kids. There is also an assigned counsel plan by which attorneys are designated to represent individuals in certain family court matters. That's so sad. The Appellate Division also oversees the Mental Hygiene Legal Service, an advocacy program whose attorneys represent the legal interests of the mentally and developmentally disabled. That's very sad. Katie isn't helping the announcements any. Gannett says Janine Pirro's husband, Al Pirro, gets $400,000 a year as a lobbyist in Albany. I don't like those lobbyists. They go up there and they take away all our rights. I want you to know about the tenant. If you're a tenant, join Tenants and Neighbors. Let me give you their number. 212-5. Conservationist, New York State Magazine, Americans for Legal Reform, justice should be fair, equal, or not be a function of prejudice, bias, or financial benefit to those in the judicial system. The legal system handles criminals' actions for show, while matters for dough, money, are handled in a manner that harasses the public. The legal system is preying upon the public's problems, and these problems are being created because of this dysfunctionalism. That's right, we have problems, and the legal system preys on them. The lawyers and the judges make money off of them. That's what it all comes down to. An announcement from the Center for Judicial Accountability. Their number is easy. It's 421, 1200, White Plains, 914. If you have your own personal horror story about judges and have made efforts to obtain redress, we urge you to write a summary of not more than 3 pages for inclusion in our file. Please indicate whether we are free to make such summary available to journalists. We certainly are mine. As you know, a chat with Glendora has celebrated its 2000th public access program. The Federal Judicial Center publishes books and makes videotapes. Oh, they're wonderful. And their purpose is to improve the work that's done in the United States District Courts to get justice. But what you see on the front line in the United States District Courts is not justice. We have here a Federalist paper saying that our population is controlled by 1% of the population. That would be the lawyers. Down with the lawyers. Falafels, 1 cup of dry garbanzos, 1 small onion chop, 1 clove garlic chop, 1 to 2 sprigs of fresh parsley, and a teaspoon of salt and seasoning. I like it when our Chief Judge, Judith Kay, hearkens to the command of Gannett to come and talk to them. I think that's undue influence. We all know that you can't trust Gannett. Gordon Burroughs is out. That's good. We are glad of that. So, we finished all of the reports for the week of March the 28th, 1996 to April the 4th, 1996. And this is April the 8th, 1996 at 4:30 a.m. The videotaping started at 2 a.m. And Katie is here asking for her dinner. No, for her breakfast. And so you keep your courage flaming. That's how we had 11, let's see, we've had 11, 12, we had about 14 half-hour programs this week reporting on the law-breaking of greedy cable operators, on the crookedness of their hired liars, L-I-A-R-S, lawyers, and of the prolonged process of the courts not keeping the law and not taking care of these matters and getting them resolved. 2.25 years. The newspaper, folks, for sale. An umbrella by a lady with 3 broken ribs. Is it difficult to become a professor, the student asks, and the professor says, no, you just do it by degrees. Dad, what's a Grecian urn? Dad, $4.20 an hour. You take care. God bless you.
I shouldn't be. The month is April. The date is the 11th. The day is Thursday. The time is 11:52 a.m. We are bringing to you a report of the law breaking and the lying of lawyers and the ineptitude of courts to administer justice. That's their business, justice.
Where I shouldn't be.
Where I shouldn't be. The month is April. The date is the 11th. The day is Thursday. The time is 11:52 a.m. We are bringing to you a report of the law breaking and the lying of lawyers and the ineptitude of courts to administer justice. That's their business, justice. They seem totally incapable of handling justice. This is the White Plains edition. And we have a joke for you. What is the longest word in the English language? Smiles. Between the first letter and the last letter is a mile. And the teacher said that toadstools live in damp places, and the little girl said, yes, that's why they are shaped like umbrellas. And the boss said, I saw you arguing with a customer. In this business, a customer is always right. And the employee says, yes, sir, the customer is always right. And the boss says, you understand that? And the employee said, yes, sir. And the boss said, what were you arguing about? And the employee said, he said you were an idiot. Now, White Plains edition, the first report is Walsh, Alpucci, and Larkin. First news, no decision. There has been no decision on the inept work of Judge Harold Wood and the inept work of Angela Ingracia of the Westchester Supreme Court. They did terrible work. And before the appellate division of the second department, and we are waiting for the decisions from those two. Report on police officer Stead, White Plains Police, the Corporation Council of White Plains, Mr. Hennenberry, and the bad work of Judge Friedman in the White Plains City Court. That was all done and ready to, it was videotaped and it was ready to be cablecast. And mysteriously, White Plains Public Access Commission did not cablecast it. The complaint was that there were lines through the character generator in the screen. Oh, and so we don't think that it ever can be cablecast. And Glendora said, okay, I will come and pick up the 3/4-inch cassette and I will look at it and I will see if there's anything wrong with it. And this morning, I looked at the archive of it, and there's nothing wrong with it. So, today is April the 11th, as I've told you, Thursday, and we will see what becomes of that. Buddy at White Plains Public Access called me up Monday night, April 11th, when it wasn't cable, on Monday, April 8th, when it allegedly could not be cablecast. All they had to do was to call me and we could bring in a replacement tape. We only live about 7 blocks from there. That's interesting that nobody ever informed me of it until Wednesday night. I was not watching at 7 p.m. Channel 14, or I would have taken care of it. That day, I had been up all night the night before, and so I was asleep by 7 p.m. So, you never can turn your back. Stenographer has put a price of $500 on the minutes at the trial, Glendora versus Stead, or the People versus Glendora, and the court stenographer will not tell me how many pages the transcript is. And any court stenographer can do that. She will not tell me how much she's charging per page. She just says that the price of the transcript is $500. And I said, well, there's a New York law that you can't charge more than $1.78 a page, so I want to know how much you're charging a page. So she is not answering me. A letter came, and it took 2 weeks for that. And it doesn't answer the questions. How many pages is the transcript? How many pages will it be? And how much are you charging per page? And she seemed to miss the point that I told her long ago it was for an appeal. And if she's going to miss that, how much is she going to miss in the courtroom? The next matter is that the order to show cause before Judge Cowie was reportedly to be pulled out of the file this morning, April the 11th, and it was to be decided if I were to get a stay of all proceedings in the White Plains City Court, the lower court, while this appeal was going on in the appellate term. So by the late this afternoon, I should know if the proceedings are going to be stayed. I have received nothing from Henenberry, nothing from Stead, nothing from Friedman. So where does that leave it? And it's not going to be a conference, an in personam conference. It's just all going to be done on paper. So late this afternoon, while I'm editing at TCI, Franklin will try to find out what happened and to see if I have to pay that $100 wrongfully charged for going through a red light, which I didn't do, and about which a policeman lied. So we will have to report to you on that next week. This is the White Plains edition of A Chat with Glendora. Breaking of Walsh, Alpucci, and Larkin. You see that this was a slow, very gradual, but very certain victory. It's down to one page. And for the stats that closed the week of April 1st, the first week of April, this beautiful month of April. By the way, we have had 24 storms. The last one hardly amounted to more than a dusting, but it did accumulate. So remember, an even two dozen storms for the year 1995-1996, for that winter, 24 snowstorms. The forsythia are getting yellow, and we already have cute little blue flowers out in the field, and I've seen numerous crocus with their sweet, sweet heads, yellow and purple and white. Oh, it's so pretty. The month of April is just so pretty. So for the first week of that, it was a day of peace. The window is out entirely in the east wall. No, not W. Wall, Walsh, Alpucci, and Larkin, but in the east wall, W-A-L-L, of the furnace room. There's been puddles in the cellar. There's no hot water at 5 a.m. There's cold air into the cellar window, and it makes things damp, and the cellar begins to smell. Mary Ann was here and cleaned up the halls in the cellar very nicely yesterday. The yellow cellar walls are beautiful, all painted yellow. And the stone is cemented so nicely, and it took four men to do it. And there's no window pane, a broken window pane there is, near the washers in the cellar, and that's gone on for a year and a half. There were puddles of water into the cellar. So the score is 3,250 tortious acts, 3,843 pages of bad record, 31 volumes, 2 hours on Wall, Alpucci, and Larkin, $0, mailing number 225, and exhibit number 99. Now we look into the second week of April in which we are, and we find out what those stats are. Wall, file. So what are we doing? We're waiting for the decision from the appellate division that Judge Wood is wrong and that Judge Ingrassia is wrong. And now we will look in the logs folder, and here we have wall somewhere. Right here. And so far it's been a week of peace. And the nicest thing happened this morning, the weather is beautiful, is that Cisa came here, and Leslie, his helper, and they finally replaced the broken window above the set tubs in the cellar. Isn't that wonderful? A year and a half. And so they also replaced the window in the furnace room. And I told them how nice the stone looked, and I told them how nice the yellow painted walls in the cellar looked, the partitions. So Monday was a day of peace, Tuesday was a day of peace, Wednesday was a day of peace, and Thursday was a day of peace. And we have that good report about Cisa. And Leslie, there was a knock at my door, and Leslie was outside, and he had cut his finger. So I had him come in and wash it all with soap and water, get the germs away. Because you can get AIDS that way, I think, can't you? That's how the AIDS virus enters your body, through an open wound. So wash it all well and dried it, and then put Samin Salve on it. Oh, can't beat Samin Salve for a disinfectant. That way you keep out all the germs, and then Band-Aid. Dr. Quack. So we have another 4 minutes on this program, so I think we'll fill it in with announcements because we don't want to start the next program because that's the Continental Edition, Austin, and north and across the river. So this is from Americans for Better America. Justice should be fair, equal, and not be a function of prejudice, bias, or financial benefit to those in the judicial system. The legal system handles criminal actions for show, while matters for dough are handled in a manner that harass the public. The legal system, quote unquote, is preying upon the public's problems, and these problems are being created because of its dysfunctionalism. You have a problem, you're supposed to be able to go to court and get justice. But what do they do in court? They prey upon you. Civil suits now take several years with no consideration given to litigants' lost income, non-productivity, and lost time out of life. Only lawyers' and judges' time is important. They're the ones who get paid. The litigants lose their money and lose their justice. Gannett annual meeting is May the 7th, 1996 in Arlington, Virginia. We've gone for the past, 3 years? Shall we get up in the middle of the night and go again? And there won't be any difference in the greed of Curley and McCorkendale and Gary Watson. They are making millions and millions per year. Upon information and belief, I believe that John J. Curley is making something like $8 million a year. And this is their annual report. Slaters were manipulated by the insurance industry to go up another $30 on our insurance. Isn't that great? We have legislators up in Albany to protect us. And what do? They just greedily steal all the money they can from us. And we have Americans for Legal Reform, remember them, in Long Island. They are the ones who are out to get rid of all of these crooked lawyers that we have. And remember the Center for Judicial Accountability, they are out to get rid of all the corrupt judges that we have. are going to speak in this chapter of the law breaking of Amos Hostetter and Nair and DeLorme and Schleyer and Townsend. And we're going to speak of the Judge Smith Court and of the Judge Parker Court. We're going to speak of the clerks. It is about discovery. That's the stage we are now at Continental. And first of all, we're going to speak of you, of some jokes. A little boy says, Dad, can I join the army? And Dad says, of course not. You're just an infant. He says, I could be in the infantry. And this is my husband's enthusiasm stool, Dorothy says. He puts everything he has into it. And Marilyn says, Mom, you know that vase that has been handed down from generation to generation? Mother, yes. Well, this generation just dropped it. In Continental File, this is file number 9, and it started on March 1st, and it started with page 1705. So we'll read you the new entries into this file. I am very, very happy, I am jubilant to report to you that I got a chance to read the wonderful pro se manual. This is put out by the pro se clerks of the United States District Clerk. It was written by Elizabeth Ann Etkin, and she did a beautiful job, and it was enormously helpful. These sections that I read, able finally to get to read on Tuesday, I read the sections on appeals, because I'm doing that, and I read the sections on the section on discovery. And it is so clear, and it is so helpful. It's a wonderful job, and we must praise our government and our judicial system that we have a pro se clerk, a pro se clerk's office. An action is a case, cause, suit, or controversy disputed or contested before a court of justice. So you file an action to get justice, okay? Written statement by a defendant responding to a complaint is called the answer. And judges say it's the most useless piece of paper in the court system. I started looking at this video cassette, How Civil Cases Move Through the District Courts, and it's wonderful. It's a teaching instrument for clerks. And any clerk who listens to this is going to be a very good clerk. And so this is the first part one. You knew that I did part four because that was about trial and judgment, and I needed it before Judge Bryant ill-advisedly stayed my trial, which is a terrible thing to do. An appeal is a review by a higher court of the judgment or decision of a lower court. A civil action. Every lawsuit other than a criminal action and an adversary proceeding for the enforcement or protection of a legal right or the redress or prevention of a wrong. That's what courts are for. They seem to have forgotten that. Every lawsuit is a civil action other than a criminal action. An adversary proceeding for the enforcement or protection of a legal right or the redress or prevention of a wrong. You've been wrong, you go to court and redress. You go to court to prevent any more of the wrong. You go to court for the enforcement or the protection of a legal right. Now, a clerk of the court is an officer appointed by a court of justice who has charge of the clerical work, who keeps the records, issues process, enters judgments and orders, and gives certified copies of documents from the record. Cost is the amount of money awarded to the successful party and recoverable from the losing party, solely as reimbursement for certain of the expenses in prosecuting or defending the suit. Damages, a monetary compensation which may be recovered in the courts by a person who has suffered a loss or injury through the unlawful act, omission, or negligence of another. All right, you start out with an unlawful act against you, an omission or a negligence against you, and then you go to the court, and the court rules in your favor that you have suffered a loss and or an injury, and then the person who did it must pay you monetary compensation. Well, in the case of Continental, these lawbreakers whose names you see on the screen, this has not happened yet because of bad work in the courts. This has not happened in Cablevision after 2.25 years because of the bad work in the courts. A deposition is an oral statement made by a person before an officer authorized by law to administer oaths. The attorney for the opposing party is notified to attend the deposition where he may cross-examine the deposed party. The deposition may sometimes be used later at trial, or it may be taken only to obtain discovery. What is discovery? Well, that's a legal term for lie and cover up. Discovery, the disclosure by one party of facts, documents, or information to the opposing party who needs this material to properly prosecute or defend the case. I am prosecuting TCI, Continental, and Cablevision. And we are in the middle of many discovery fights, as you have heard. I played some for you on last week's tapes. I am exuberant to announce that I got the Continental work caught up. It maybe only lasted a couple of hours that it was caught up before other stuff starts coming in, but I did get it caught up. And that was on my way to Nassau County to Cablevision on Tuesday, April the 9th, and it was somewhere along the northern state, and I did get caught up, and that was around 1:30 or 2:30 in the afternoon. I've been struggling trying to get this mailing out for a week. So far there are three pieces in here, and I believe these three pieces have been read to you, made a matter of record to you. And it goes to 16 people, all of the defendants and several judges who should know while things are on the front lines of the United States District Court. Deputy Clerk James Galvin did not get a paper, an urgent paper, that I handed in before 9 o'clock on Monday. Did not get it to Judge Smith by 4 p.m. Tuesday. And I handed in the paper on James Galvin's bench. He has a little bench. She has the big bench. And they're 5 feet apart from each other. And he couldn't get that paper from his bench, the lower bench in the courtroom, to her, 5 feet away from him, in 2 days. So when I stood up for my rights on that matter, Judge Smith flew into a tantrum and, in a rage, walked out of the courtroom and left everything undone, plus give the lawbreakers a 2-week extension. Well, we took that audio tape that you heard and we transcribed it. And this is the transcript, folks. And Franklin did all of the transcribing and it took him about an hour. And so we handed in the transcript so that it would be in the files. I can't get around because these papers are holding down the microphone cord. But Glendora does not want to alienate Deputy Clerk James Galvin nor Judge Smith. She loves them both very much. But Glendora is firm, and she's firm about her rights as her ancestors taught her to be. Glendora has a right to rely on James Galvin to get an urgent paper left on his bench in the courtroom just 5 feet under the nose of the judge, to the judge. A paper left on Mr. Galvin's bench in the courtroom, 8:45 a.m. on April 1st, 1996, Monday, should have been delivered to the judge by 4 p.m. April the 2nd, 1996, Tuesday. That is a right unless it's an April Fool's joke. This is an American's right, through and through. Glendora was damaged by Mr. Galvin's failure. A two-week delay, a decision by Judge Smith with no hearing from Glendora, a judge storming off the bench in uncontrollable rage, a preclusion of 20 other topics Glendora had prepared for hours to present that day, left over from the last two previous conferences. A job has to be done right, especially in a court. Right is right and wrong is wrong. Again, the judge read Walsh's two paper that Galvin got to her. Why did not Galvin get Glendora's paper to the judge 5 feet from her bench? The programs 2060, 2061, and 2062 Glendora made on April 3rd, 1996 should be seen Saturday, April 6th, on Continental, but Hostetter et al. Censored it. Now it will have to be seen on another system, and that's not in the community of interest. This is violation of Glendora's free speech and the public's First Amendment right to know. Your right to know. Your right is being violated here. And then 2061 will not be seen until Saturday, 3 p.m., April the 13th. 2 weeks old, and 2062, also about Continental, the week of April 1st, will not be seen probably on Continental at all. Irreparable harm, violation of free speech, censorship, while this is what you call a Judge Bear decision. Okay? In favor of the lawbreakers and against the innocent. Let's defendants manipulate it. A court that lets defendants manipulate it. The lawbreakers have the say, the injured and innocent have no sway. What are courts for anyhow? What happened was dishonest and dirty, get a clean job. Courts should be a blessing to the wounded, not a scourge. Yours in truth, Glendora. A chat with Glendora. And copy to Thomas Walsh II, who caused it all by not getting his papers in on time and not doing his work, and outlying in the sun somewhere. Now, this objection by plaintiff that defendant's answers to her discovery demands is inadequate. That's another one that was written since you and I met last time. To the Honorable Lisa Margaret Smith, United States Magistrate Judge, what Mr. Walsh, too, made a great show handing in to Glendora before your eyes on April the 2nd, 96, Tuesday, 4:08 p.m., was a fake. The defendant's discovery papers handed in to plaintiff are inadequate, insufficient, and evasive. These papers are enclosed for you to see. Glendora is right. They tell me nothing. There is no information in them. They do not tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. If they have done nothing wrong, then they should be eager and proud to tell their story. Glendora is. The interrogatories are all written by the lawyer. They are perfunctorily signed by Hostetter, Sanders, Guthrie, Rainey, Cooper. This is against what you ordered on February the 27th, 1996, Tuesday at 3 p.m. And this is against Federal Rules of Civil Procedure 33B2. The lawyer is not supposed to answer. The defendant is supposed to answer. For documents, Mr. Walsh, too, Hostetter et al., produce only papers that Glendora has. Defendant's response for documents and interrogatories is a total failure. You said February the 27th, around 2:55 p.m., that discovery was to be done in phases. First the documents and the interrogatories. That's a good idea. But here Mr. Walsh, too, is pirouetting with an oral deposition of Glendora with admissions. Not that I mind. But it isn't what the judge said to do. Defendant's lawyer do not respond to Glendora's demands for oral depositions. Walsh, too, does not do what the court tells him to do and does what the court doesn't tell him to do. Judge Smith asked a good question on April the 2nd, 1996, Tuesday at 4:10 p.m. Can't you get in touch with these people in their employment? They must be accessible by U.S. mail. Mr. Walsh, too, never answered this good question. There was no answer to Glendora's demand for inspection of premises, Federal Rules of Civil Procedure, Rule 34. Surely there must be a file on this matter, memos and electronic memos. Glendora's birthday is May 1st. This is Law Day. What are you going to give her for a present? What year is my birthday? What year? Every year. Walsh, too, should be reading Federal Rules of Civil Procedure instead of New York State Civil Practice Laws and Rules. Defendants are fugitives of discovery as they were of service. Why does the court put up with this? Get the job done. Every 2 weeks delay, totally unjustified, costs us, increases damages, stress, deprives us of our private lives. What is the score today on April the 8th, 1996, Monday? 431 and a half hours. We're into our 35th week. I have seen no justice. We have spent $789.73. And at 431 and a half hours times $250 per hour is what lawyers get for legal work, then that's $107,875 worth of legal work. This lawbreaking has cost us. And these dilatory courts have cost us. 2,063 pages of bad record of these defendants, whose name you see on the screen. 42 reports on TV, a half an hour each. The list of producers does not have telephone numbers. Will the court please order these, as did another judge of a cable operator? Defendant's lawyer make a mockery of all of the time and care and thought the court put into the fine case management plan of February 27th. This valiant work by the court was zapped to zilch by the fraud, deceit, deviousness, delay of the defendants. Hear ye, Americans for a better America says it all. Justice should be fair, equal, and not be a function of prejudice, bias, or financial benefit to those in the judicial system. The legal system handles criminal actions for show, while matters for dough are handled in a manner that harass the public. The legal system is preying upon the public's problems, and these problems are being created because of its dysfunctionalism. Civil suits now take several years with no consideration given to litigants' lost income, non-productivity, and lost time out of life. Only lawyers' and judges' time is important. They're the ones who make the money. Defendants have defaulted in old Glendora $298,000. Defendants' lawyer malpractice defy Local Rule 9. They have never answered Local Rule 9. Defendants are in violation of Rule 826, New York Executive Law, Article 28, now Public Service Law, no 6 months notice for discontinuance of service. Mr. Walsh, too, defies court order, provide Mr. Guthrie's address by March the 1st, Friday, 1996. Glendora renews her request for home addresses, Local Rule 2. She got them on another case, why shouldn't she hear? January the 5th, February the 27th, and April the 2nd, Glendora never got her chance to bring up the points on her list. Has Judge Smith made any conclusions from her cogitation on improper editorial control? I've been waiting for 2 months to hear this. Has Judge Smith seen a chat with Glendora? If so, how many times, where, when, and what does she think of it? Defendants have not produced their insurance agreements. If all that Mr. Walsh, too, said were true in his letter to the court, March the 28th, 1996, then how come he came up with papers, false that they were, on April the 2nd, 1996, at 4 p.m.? How long will it be before trial? Mr. Walsh never declares under penalty of perjury. Mr. Walsh did not sign his March the 28th letter, Rule 11, Federal Rules of Civil Procedure. Defendant's lawyer answers to discovery. Documents and interrogatories are as trite as was her answer in mid-September to Glendora's complaint. Why does the court allow such fluff? In discovery, Glendora has to find out who made the decision, with what authority, what is its genesis, who approved. But remember, all defendants are liable as managers and officers and board members. Diligent and law-abiding employees would not have broken the law, nor let it be broken. And long ago, Glendora said this. In Gannett newspapers, Diane Rainey said they would have more public access time in their rebuild than they could be filled. Then why did they rob us of every other program? Why didn't she wait? The law says first come, first serve, 829.3 and 8521 et sec. How long is it going to take this court to enforce this law? And then to show you what kind of people that you're dealing with, TCI and Continental Cable, and ripping the customers off, overcharging them. Sanctions imposable for violations of the federal rules of civil procedure, discovery problems in civil cases, publications by the Federal Judicial Center. Glendora moves his court to compel discovery. Does she have your permission? Mr. Walsh's attitude was bad. Hand in these discovery papers, hand in these answers. She can always object, then the judge will rule. This is a waste of scant judicial resources. Yours in truth, Glendora. And that paper was handed in. I believe yesterday, Wednesday, April the 10th. This is a very fine order by Judge Smith about discovery that was submitted to us on January the 5th. And what happens when you object to discovery? Answers that they're inadequate. I don't know. I think we spent about $30 on printing these things. And the postage hasn't even come up yet. Now, this protest was read to you last week. This is Glendora's answer to any doctors was read to you last week. And that's a stupid thing that Thomas E. Walsh II did. Glendora claimed emotional disturbance with no physical effect, and here he is asking about doctors. Boost. The little papers like this. And then all of these little cut, and then they have to be cut. And then they have to, and then you have to make a master of them so that you'll end up with 4 pages per sheet to cut down the cost of printing and to cut down the cost of postage. Stop looking like this. Objection to discovery. I sent the stack of the duplicate copies that Walsh II had provided. I sent that whole stack to the court. Glendora answers defendant's notice to produce upon her. Walsh II says of the below named attorney, of the below named attorney. Couldn't Walsh II simply say the attorney who is named below? Or simply say his name? The contract between the plaintiff and any of the defendants under which plaintiff claims to be grandmothered is produced below. Now I think I can come around because this huge pile is off of the microphone cord. And this was my contact with Continental Cable way back in December of 93. And see, I give a local sponsor, Linda and Mark Davies in Tarrytown in their system. And so this is the contract that grandmothers made from any new regulations they have. This is what I signed. They come up with all these foolish things like a disclaimer. They should put up the disclaimer. They should say that the views don't reflect those of the cable company. They should do that. Cablevision does that in Nassau. I've never seen TCI do it, or anybody else. And the old rules under which the plaintiff claims to be grandmothered, Glendora's answer is the same as I just showed you, and all correspondence from the defendants. We have this odious letter from the screwy decision to cut the programs down from every week to every other week. So, breaking the law, clear as it could be, first come, first served. We have this, calling for a meeting of access producers, and to show you how phony Diane Rainey and Melissa Cooper and these defendants are, they never came through with that meeting. I said I would go, and then they canceled it. And this so-called rule book, which says right away that public access is first come, first served, it says it's twice, and this letter from Diane Rainey saying, I wanted to make sure you received a community access programming operating rules and procedure booklet, which you will find attached to this letter. and produce number 4 and number 5, all audio tapes of conversations with the defendants, all videotapes dealing with the defendants, and defendants will have to come to Glendora's office, Glendora says to them, and she will play the audio tapes and the videotapes. You bring your own equipment to make dubs off of regular cassettes, microcassettes, 8mm, and VHS. Glendora has the connectors. Glendora will not let these tapes out of her sight or hearing. They are all originals, and there's only one of a kind, and there are no copies. If you want Glendora to make dubs, you will have to pay in advance. Glendora has been stiff since October the 26, 1995, for an audio dub she made Crooked Lawyers Satterley Stevens Burke and Burke for $95. No more credit will be extended to a lawyer nor defendant. Produce number 6. All videos should be produce number 6. Produce is what you eat and tastes so good. All videotapes of the plaintiff's program, which the plaintiff claims have been altered, edited, or censored by the defendants. Well, Glendora does not recall any such. Produce her a copy of your claim. This is not signed by you. Grow up. Dated White Plains, New York, April the 9th, 1996. Yours in truth, Glendora. Chat with Glendora. Glendora wants you to produce all insurance policies in the name of the insurance company's account executives. And I think that went out April 10th. And here's what's going out today. So you ask yourself, what's going on today on Continental? Well, I'll tell you. Here it is. There it is. Notice of appeal. Take notice that Plaintiff Glendora hereby exercises her right to appeal the unjust memorandum decision in order of the Honorable Barrington D. Parker, Jr., United States District Court, Southern District of New York. A judge doesn't get my honor doing things like this. This order was issued March the 12th, 1996. Judge Parker wrongfully denied Glendora's order to show cause for a temporary restraining order and preliminary injunction that defendants cease prohibiting and limiting the cable casting of her TV show from every week to every other week. Glendora appeals Judge Parker's order in each and every part. Glendora appeals to the United States Court of Appeals for the Second Circuit. White Plains, New York, April 11, 1996, a chat with Glendora, Box 416, White Plains, New York. Let me just sign that. It has to be an original signature. Rule 11. 914-949-9495. Thomas E. Walsh II, Esquire, Box 238, Congress, New York, 10920. His office is in a box. Now, that stack of envelopes I showed you, those all have to be opened up. And a copy of this notice of appeal has to go in them. And this afternoon, Franklin is going to the United States District Court, and he's going to give to the clerk this notice of appeal. It costs $105 to appeal, but I'm in forma pauperis, and that fee is waived. And then you have to give them a copy for every defendant. And of this appeal, we have to make our own copies. And so Franklin is going to hand in about 17 copies, and then he's going to get about 20 copies to stuff in the envelopes. This is the mailing list for Continental. It includes every one of the fugitive defendants, and then it includes the judges. And it includes some federal people. See the TV camera back there. So it's not like a mirror, and it's not like showing it to you in person, and you get all mixed up which way to move. Report on the law breaking of these people for the second week of April, and the lying about it and the covering up about it and the inability of the courts to bring the thing to justice. And Billy says, Mom, am I made of sage
and parsley and breadcrumbs? No, why?
Well, Billy said he's going to beat the stuffing out of me. You folks out there in Nassau County, to a chat with Glendora, the Nassau County edition, what happened from April the 4th to April the 11th, 1996, Anno Domini. Everything is all mixed up. I reported to you last week that we had Cablevision work pretty much up to date, except for the old work that's been behind for a year and a half we can't get to. So we're going to start off with some jokes. Grandmother said to Marilyn, would you like to see the cuckoo come out of the cuckoo clock? And Marilyn says, yes, please, and I'd like to see grandfather come out of the grandfather clock. Is this your brother? The priest asks the little boy. And the little boy says, yes. And the priest says, well, he's kind of small, isn't he? And the little boy says, well, that's because he's just my half-brother. And Johnny says, my baby brother is only a year old, and he's been walking now for 9 months. And Henry says, really? Gee, he must be tired. These are video cassettes, a format that you are very familiar with. These are the archives of a chat with Glendora. The program that you're looking at now is on 3/4-inch cassette. That's the only format that Cablevision Long Island can cablecast from. And these are very, very important because that was Clerk Richard at the United States Court of Appeals, Second Circuit, about an argument, oral argument on a motion. These turn out to be very important because they are programs that were submitted to Cablevision to be played on Friday, November the 12th, 1993. And then November 20th, and then November 27th, and then the first Friday in December. And they were excoriating reports.
And drive 100 miles looking for a sign that says home cooking.